Thank you very much, Andrea, for that great intro to usability testing and giving the audience the overall perspective on how do you go about, why do you test, how do you go about creating a test. I'm going to talk about a specific case study that I worked on with Carol at Crossref, and hopefully this will give you a little bit more detail on, you know, what this looks like in practice. And I will say, by way of introducing myself, I'm Kirsten Robinson. I'm currently working as user experience architect at Endeca Technologies, who you might know for their faceted search that you'll find in a lot of online publication sites. But at the time that I did this study with Carol, I was working for an information design consultancy called Dynamic Diagrams down in Providence. So this was from my previous job. And as is common in these things, I am going to review what the goals of our test were, as well as a little bit about our participants, the methodology that we used, which you'll find it very much followed what Andre was talking about, but there was a little bit of a difference, and I'll mention that when we get there. And I'll also talk about some of the findings and some of the recommendations and what was changed in the CrossMark product as a result of our findings. So first of all, how many of you have heard of CrossMark? Okay, great. You guys are doing a good job on your marketing. Since you know a lot about it, I'll go through this quickly, but the idea is basically to help researchers distinguish between publication versions on the web and find out, is this document being maintained by the publisher, or is it maybe been screen scraped and put on someone else's site? And is it the current canonical version of the article, or are there updates that might be available, or errata, or things like that? And it helps publishers show that they're doing something to keep their content trustworthy. So our goals for the usability test, and this was when the CrossMark service was fairly early in its development, we wanted to find out if there were any usability issues with it before it went on the market. And we were specifically looking at the researcher audience, which was the primary audience for the product. I think in the publishing world it's kind of interesting because usually the people who are making purchase decisions are, say, university librarians and so forth, but the users are researchers who don't have the same sophisticated search and information usage skills that librarians do. So it's important that the product work for those folks. And another goal of the test was to help Crossref select a logo for CrossMark. There had been some they were sort of at an impasse internally about which logo would be the best one to use. And so this is what the CrossMark service looks like in context. This was a mock-up that we did for the purpose of the usability testing. And you can see over there on the left-hand side above the title of the article is the CrossMark logo. And in this case, the user has rolled over it, and there's a tooltip that says, click here to check the status of this document. And the logo itself underneath, it's kind of hard to read on the PowerPoint, but it says, click to verify. And what the hope was with the usability testing that researchers would see this logo, they would have some idea of what it might mean, and they would click on it to find out more. And for publishers, of course, they care about things like, does the logo fit into the design of their online publications? And, you know, does it not detract from other aspects of the publication or distract people too much? So this is, because we were testing different logos, this screenshot has a different logo in it, but now you can see that if a researcher did click on this logo, this is then what they would see. They'd see some metadata about the document. They'd have a DOI, which is a persistent link to see the current version of the document, or yes, the current version, as well as some additional metadata. If there had been updates to the document, the information about updates and other statuses would also appear here. So our participants, because we were looking at researchers, we recruited both PhDs and PhD students, and we chose people specifically from the scientific, technical, and medical fields because in those fields it's more common to have errata and updates to articles, especially, you know, that may be very significant, like imagine a drug study for cancer treatments or something like that. You'd want to know that you were looking at the article that had the correct version of the data. All of the people in the study used the web at least 5 hours a week. We don't want to test how good they are at using the web. We want people who already know how to use the web. We don't really think that there's a lot of difference between how men and women use web or online journals, but I think it's always good to balance those kind of characteristics. And so we got a mix of men and women, and we also had a mix of age groups, because we do sometimes see as people get older, people tend to have more problems with eyesight and, dexterity and things like that. So you want to make sure that you're not just testing with, say, college-age people. We also tried to balance what browsers people were using. 5 of our users were on Safari, 2 on Firefox. We actually didn't find any PC users to do our study, so they were all on Mac, which was just kind of an ironic thing. But we're not too concerned about that because, we're not studying how well they use their system or their browser, but more how well they use the CrossMark service. And these users were recruited and screened through a process. First of all, we posted some recruiting news items on various websites, and we invited people to fill out a survey that would help us qualify them to make sure they were, in fact, PhDs or PhD students in STM. And then that was followed up by a couple of phone conversations to verify their qualifications and schedule their test and make sure that they had the right equipment, because we were doing this test through, we were doing a remote test, not in a usability lab like Andrea was talking about, but we're actually using WebEx, so we wanted to make sure they had a system that would work with WebEx. And also just the number of survey respondents we had 55 people respond, and of that we recruited 7 people who qualified and were available for the study at the time that we needed them to be. So the methodology, and Andrea went into a great description of how you go about testing. The differences were, we were doing this over WebEx and phone, so we couldn't actually see people interacting with the service, which is a little bit of a disadvantage, but the advantage is you can recruit people from all over the world, it's less expensive, people don't have to travel, And you can also have remote observers very unobtrusively because they can be in your WebEx session with their phones muted and the participant hardly even knows that they're there. The participants shared and controlled their own desktops, so it was very much like they would normally work on their computer. They just had to do a little bit of extra work to get WebEx up and running. We did use the Think Aloud protocol, which I think Andrea described very well, so I won't go into detail about that. We had some pre- and post-study questions. Pre-study, we asked them a little bit about their use of online journals. Post-study, I have a slide later on, and I'll talk about what we asked them there. And we did provide Amazon gift certificates as an incentive. It's a great choice when you're doing remote testing because you just email it to them after the test, and you can do it in their native currency if they're in another country. We did have one person from Canada, I think, but he actually was in the U.S., so I think we all did U.S. dollars. So for the content of the test itself, our examples were all mocked up based on articles from the Public Library of Science journal. We had a mixture of different examples. We had an article that was current and that was something that you would view in HTML through a normal browser interface. We had an article that had corrections to it. We had an article that was on a site other than PLOS, so the domain name was wrong. And we also had an article that was in PDF format because the CrossMark service actually does work with PDF, and we wanted to make sure that people would recognize that. And you can see here a few of the tasks. We basically repeated task 3 here for all of these different examples. Tasks 1 and 2 we only did with the first example, because we were trying to find out if people noticed the logo and recognized what it was and clicked on it. So after they did the first task, they already sort of learned what they were supposed to do. So we didn't repeat that task each time, because it would have biased further results. And we also had a task that I don't show here, which was just a logo preference task at the very end. So what did we find out? So first of all, we wanted to know, did people notice the logo and did they click on it? And we had kind of 3 stages to this. One was just sort of like letting them explore the page as a whole and seeing if they noticed the logo. If they didn't notice it, I would direct their attention to the logo and say, what do you think that image is up there above the title? And they would take a guess. And then I would say, now move your mouse over it, and they'd get the tooltip. And I'd say, now what do you think it is? And then finally, you know, if they hadn't spontaneously clicked on it, we'd let them click on it. Two people noticed the logo as they were exploring the page, but no one spontaneously clicked on it the first time they saw it. And this was about what we expected to happen, actually, because, you know, think about it. You probably see trustee logos and VeriSign logos and things like that, but do you ever click on them? And this is a very similar kind of concept. Five people through the course of the test, after they did the first task where we sort of directed them to click on the logo, they learned to click on it, and they kind of spontaneously did that. We did have one guy who was a little bit cranky, and he never voluntarily clicked on the logo, so we had to ask him every time. Okay, and then the other thing we wanted to find out is, you know, could people grok what the Crossmark service was? So this is kind of what our findings were for their initial response to the logo. So just looking at it, they weren't sure what it was. They were thinking, oh, you know, it says click to verify underneath. So is it going to let me save a list of articles? Is it going to let me give some feedback? You know, what does this word verify really mean? What am I verifying? Once they rolled over it, then they got the tooltip that said click here to check the status of this document. At that point, they really homed in on the word status, and they conjectured that this had to do with finding out what state the article was in the publishing workflow. Was it submitted, reviewed, accepted, or published? One person did guess correctly that it might have to do with finding out if there were any corrections or retractions. So I think we were silently clapping on the other end of the WebEx session when that happened. After they went through several tasks with several different examples at the kind of towards the end of the test, how people interpreted Crossmark at this point was a lot of people interpreted it as, you know, 6 out of 7 people, a way to find out if there are corrections or updates. Yay. Other people recognized that it would also, through that DOI, allow you to get to the publisher-maintained version of the article. And then there were some other interpretations that were fairly on target, you know, that this article is being tracked, it's verified, it's valid. You know, I'm on the publisher's site, you know, I know if there's some reason to suspect that this article might not be legitimate. And our cranky guy, of course, said, it's superfluous because I only browse journals on the official website. Although I don't think he picked up on the fact when he wasn't on the official website. So. And then our third big question was, which version of the logo should we use? We actually had 3 in the test. These were the 2 that ended up tying, so we weren't able to completely settle that argument. But we did find out some characteristics that made a good logo, things like it looks like a button. In the world of usability professionals, we say it has a click affordance. The icon, people liked a logo where the icon was larger than the name. And they also liked when the text hint, the words click to verify, was larger so they could read it. And they had a couple of comments about the specific logos, like the red one, they said it looks like a bookmark, a repository, a prize, a certification, which are all, you know, kind of connote the kinds of things you want it to connote. And the green one, they said, oh, well, green, that means go or okay. So, you know, again, sort of positive connotations there. Ultimately, Crossref did not choose either of these logos, but you'll find out what they did choose. Some other findings that we had. First of all, overall, the response to the Crossmark service was positive to neutral. You know, there was the one cranky guy. And people really valued that they could have access to corrections, errata, and the persistent links. Those were all valuable features for them. There were a few words in the interface that were confusing to people, like the click to verify didn't really mean anything to people, and the status obviously led them in the direction of the publishing workflow. And in that pop-up screen that we saw briefly, there was a status listed there that would be something like version of record or corrected version of record. And people got really confused by corrected version of record, although part of the reason why they did was our example had an issue with it where it wasn't really an example of a corrected version of record. So no, not surprising that people were confused. And that's actually, I think we didn't really touch on that, but if you are testing with a prototype in your usability testing, it's really important to test and retest your prototype before the test to make sure it's not going to, that the interface that people are studying isn't going to bias them in some way to get the wrong answer or to do something unexpected. One other finding was if an article doesn't have any corrections, people weren't really sure, like, well, why does this crossmark thing really matter? It was sort of became apparent. As soon as they saw one with corrections, they were like, oh, so. I mentioned before that we did ask some questions at the end of the study, and this is a way of introducing, this particular set of questions is a way that you can introduce some quantitative data into a usability study. These questions are actually based on a sort of validated set of questions called SUMMI, S-U-M-M-I, if you want to Google it later. So we sort of plugged in the word crossmark, and I think we made a couple of slight adjustments to those questions. But the idea is you ask a set of positive and negative questions, and you get people to agree or disagree on a Likert scale. And that way people can't just go down checking off, you know, five for everything or one for everything. And so I've reordered the answers in order of sort of positivity. So the four questions at the top are the sort of positive questions. And so you can see, you know, where people fell in the sort of agree to strongly agree space. And then the three questions at the bottom are the three negative questions, like I found crossmark unnecessarily complex. And you can see where people fell in the sort of strongly disagree to neutral space. So probably, you know, for the most part, the responses were very good. The one that sort of starts to get into neutral territory is this last one. And this is something that you can kind of, if you're doing repeated usability tests and iterating your designs, you can keep repeating those questions as you go through it, so you'll have a baseline and you'll see if your responses are improving or not. Hopefully they are improving as you make fixes to your design. So finally, the recommendations that we made as a result of the testing were, first of all, about the logo, that it should have a click affordance. In other words, it looks like you can click it. Looks like a button, with a high contrast color. And we recommended a horizontal orientation, which wasn't really based on the testing, but more, you know, screens are horizontal. You're usually concerned about maximizing how much content you can see vertically. So a horizontal orientation means you just take up less of the space vertically with the logo. We recommended, you know, making the text big enough and clear enough so that it was readable, and making the descriptive text a little more, the rollover text a little more descriptive. I think the recommendation was click to get updates and verify authenticity, since those were the sort of value propositions that people really bought into. The logo position, again, this wasn't so much from the testing, but just from usability best practices. One of the things we know about how users use websites is they typically sort of go from the top left to the lower right. You can see heat map studies and things with eye tracking to show what people tend to focus on a web page. So we suggested upper left near other important article information like the title would be the best position to make this pop out, and also surrounding it with some white space so that it, you know, was very visible. And finally, we made some recommendations for optimizing the pop-up design. So the order in which the information was presented on that was really important, because I think another thing we know from usability is that people, and we certainly saw in this test, is that people don't read on the web. They don't read every word on the page. They don't focus on everything on the page. They scan and skip over things, and they look for links, and they look for other things that pop out. So the order in which you present information is really important, because you want the most important information first, or the high-value information for your target audience. We also made some recommendations about text formatting and labeling, keeping the language as brief and simple as possible, again, to promote that sort of scanning and skimming behavior. We recommended inserting some icons and help buttons for any concepts that might be a little complicated, like the status, for example. So after the design changes, this is what the final logo looked like. As you can see, it looks like a button. It has a nice big hint that says click for updates, even with an arrow pointing to the button. The icon's bigger than the words and all that good stuff that we found from the user data. And here you can see what the logo looks like in context in an article. And then this was the new design for the pop-up that Dynamic Diagrams put together. And so you can see that it really focuses on the high value aspects of what the users told us in the test. It tells you the document's current, and because they didn't understand why you'd need Crossmark for a current article, they added future updates, if any, will be listed below. So it kind of primes people to check this in the future to see, you know, if there are any updates. And then you can see some other formatting changes to some of the metadata that's below. And that concludes my case study. Thank you very much.